Hello there and welcome to season two of Tusken Radio. We are back. My name is Drew Grech.
I'm Mike Badrov.
And I'm Angus Allan.
And we are back for season two. Very happy to be here. It's been an eventful
summer. We are so back.
We are talking about Star Wars delays. It's surprising nobody.
Ahsoka.
Kathleen Kennedy Ahsoka. Could be leaving soon. SAG has joined the WGA in their fight. Lando has some new writers. And we have the first three episodes of Ahsoka to talk about. So
Let's
I'm
go.
Very excited.
Let's go.
All that and more right after this. In a move that has surprised absolutely nobody.
Surprised me.
Star Wars movies have been delayed again.
Wow.
So there were movies set for December of 2025 and December of 2027.
Which movies were those?
So we don't know. I had speculated that they were the new Jedi Order film with
Rian Johnson.
Daisy Ridley? Yeah.
Okay.
For the first one. And then I thought the second one was going to be either Dave Filoni's Heir to the Empire movie. And again, these are not like official titles. This is what I'm calling this. It's not like untitled Dave Filoni Star Wars.
Speculations.
And then, and then the one after that would have probably been James Mangold, his Dawn of the Jedi film. So there is still a movie set for release on December 17th, 2027.
Droid Tales.
And then there are two movies set for 2026.
Oh.
We have a film on May 22nd, which I believe is New Jedi Order, and then a film on December 18th, which I believe is Heir to the Empire.
Cool. Only 3 years.
Wow. Only 3 years. I mean, look, I'm getting a lot of like flashbacks and just I'm thinking back on, 2018, mm-hmm. when we had Solo open up about 3 weeks after Avengers and Infinity War and just how badly that movie flopped. It's the only Star Wars to ever lose money at the box office.
What's the correlation?
Actually, good movie. Good movie.
Good movie.
Good movie.
What's the correlation between Solo and Endgame there?
That Infinity War's opening 1 month before was a detractor to Solo's box office performance.
That makes sense.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
And then, I don't know. It's just two Star Wars movies in the same year. It doesn't really seem like I don't think this is a final schedule. I don't believe that we are going to get three movies in the course of 18 months. I don't think it's going
to
happen.
To add a little bit of the devil's advocate side, Marvel movies released multiple movies in the same year. Taking, for example, Black Panther, Civil War. Those both did really well at the box office.
Yes, they did. But those are also really, really good movies. You know, Star Wars recently, I really liked four of the five Disney Star Wars movies. For the general audience, there's not a huge, like, overwhelming love for mm-hmm. Star Wars right now. I mean, the Ahsoka numbers are down. They are about the same as Andor was when that first premiered. It's down about 50% from Boba Fett, Kenobi, and Mando Season 3. So I don't really see them releasing two movies in the same year. I really like, just one movie every 2 years. I think that works for Star Wars and makes them feel like an event.
I mean, you want to go?
Yeah, I'll go with that. Drew, I think what you say does have some merits because when it's more spread out, when it's more sparse, it does make it feel more special, right?
It's like not going for ice cream every day.
Exactly. Yeah. But at the same time, going for ice cream every night or every week is still awesome, right? And
I'm not
in my ideal world as a NPC average Star Wars fan, I would want a good decent movie every year, right? I think Lucasfilm and Disney have an insane amount of resources, and despite the fact that they won't pay their actors or their workers, once they get the SAG-AFTRA affair settled, I think they should be able to go back to making movies consistently.
Every 2 years, man, Angus is going to be bald.
I mean, look, in the
time is ticking.
Era, they came out every 3 years. It was every 3 years.
That's because he only made three movies. Yeah. And then he waited like 30 years and they made...
It was 16 years. And those were 3 years apart. I'm just saying, Star Wars, to me, just didn't really feel like an event during the Disney era. Like, it was cool, there was a new Star Wars movie, but it just... I mean, by the time we got to Episode 9, even I felt a little bit burnt out on it. Like, it was just... To me, not burnt out on Star Wars, just like, it was... To me, it was just too much. I think they should have slowed down. And we have had a long break. And
we didn't have any shows during Rise of Skywalker.
Yes, we did.
Which one?
Mandalorian and Rise of Skywalker came out at the same time.
Yeah, I mean, personally, I don't know how anyone would be able to be burnt out
at that point.
But I see where you're coming from. So, yeah, I think overall, to kind of, you know...
Summarize. Recap.
I think that... Even if it does somehow follow that exact schedule, it would be awesome to have Star Wars movies so close together. But at the same time, I think just a more even spread out schedule would be nicer.
And I'm not saying that these movies will be bad. I'm just saying it worries me for the general audience that, like, we're getting movies over the course of 18 months.
Sure.
I'm saying...
I'd rather have it spread out a little bit.
I think that we won't expect anything. We can't expect anything. But when the Star Wars movie do come out, you're going to see me in the theaters. That's what's going to happen.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
And same for me. All right. When we come back, we will be talking about the flop of Indiana Jones and what that could mean for the future of Kathleen Kennedy at Lucasfilm.
Okay, no. We need to work on our singing, Badrov.
So, first of all... Remember when I do
this, we'll have a choral performance at the end of the season.
Yep.
Drew, are you starting again?
Yep.
Sunny day.
Looking at the total runtime, how does a...
Yeah, those are not... I did not edit those. The segment length is what it is. But it does still add up to 1 hour. Yeah. I did that math.
Fuck, I missed Danny. I wanted it.
Silence.
10, 9, 8... 7, 6, 5, 4.
So it's not like Lucasfilm is not making movies, because we just had the release of Indiana Jones and the Dial of Destiny, a movie that I liked. There were a couple of big issues with it, but it flopped hard.
Drew finally gets his Indiana Jones segment.
I talked for 20 seconds. it's one of the biggest money losers in Disney history. With $100 million lost over $100 million.
I thought it was a good movie.
I really liked it. For me, it's my third favorite. But
I have not had the chance to see it yet.
I've been kind of thinking, like, all right, under the Kathleen Kennedy era, and she is, I mean, Steven Spielberg said, Kathleen Kennedy is the greatest producer in the history of Hollywood. But that doesn't mean she's a great head of the studio. Like, you don't have... Michael Jordan run a basketball team.
He did that, the Charlotte Hornets, for a while and made a lot of money.
I don't know no sports. Anyway.
I mean, Kathleen Kennedy is making a lot of money, too.
She is.
That doesn't mean it's always quality.
Yeah. And with Bob Iger coming back to Disney, it seems like he's trying to correct a lot of the mistakes made by Bob Chapek. I just don't believe Kathleen Kennedy is cut out for the role that she's in now. I think that, like, if she can go back to producing movies, she produced Jurassic Park. She produced Schindler's List.
Produced Mandalorian Season 1.
She did.
She produced Mandalorian Season 2 and 3. Produced Andor.
Mm-hmm.
All things that you have given much grace to.
Because she's a great producer.
Right.
Yeah. No, I think overall... When people just, to not use bad words, when people just complain and complain and complain and they kind of dump on everything that Kathleen Kennedy makes, I think not only is that childish, but it's ignorant, right? Mm-hmm. Because you're completely ignoring the fact that she has some great projects in her resume.
That's...
I think she just needs a shift of position.
Yeah, I mean, and look, like here's the main thing, is there have been so many Star Wars movies that have just been announced that have just been canceled, or we've had director change or been changed media, or that have changed mediums like Boba Fett and Kenobi. And she just has never really been able to, for the most part, get on the same page as her filmmakers, and it's caused a lot of issues.
Mm-hmm. May I ask how you know this?
Is all just from very reliable reports from like Variety and Deadline and Hollywood Reporter about. I mean, even with, we are going to talk about it later with Lando and Jason Simeon leaving. But okay.
Drew actually has his own personal Imperial probe droid.
Exactly. Yes.
Yeah. And you know, I think that what she does next is going to be great. I just think that George maybe didn't, and George is a great director. George is a great filmmaker, but I think he maybe didn't choose his successor best
wisely.
Yeah. I stay neutral on this. I think Kathleen Kennedy has been doing her job pretty well the past couple of years, and I think that I haven't seen much of evidence that points to her as the problem. But I can understand if your sources, I trust you as a person. So let's move
on. All right. Well, when we come back, we'll be talking about the Screen Actors Guild joining the WGA on strike, shutting down everything.
I have spoken.
So toward the end of last year, we talked about how the WGA had gone on strike and what that could mean for the future of not just Star Wars, but of the entire film and TV industry as a whole. Well, about a month and a half ago, the Screen Actors Guild joined them. And this has shut down anything else. Because, like, you know, Andor Season 2 had been written. So they could keep filming. And Tony Gilroy could continue to perform his duties as director and showrunner, just not as a writer. But yeah, that has been shut down. Any reshoots needed on The Acolyte or Skeleton Crew, though, those have been shut down.
Deadpool
3 has been shut down. Oh. I was super excited for Deadpool 3.
I'm so excited.
Like, right after all those, like, images went out about, like, him and Hugh Jackman, it was like, let's go, and now it's gone. But yeah.
But it's for a good cause.
Yes, and it has.
I have been trying to follow as much as I can, and I'm not the most statistically informed, but I do know it's unfair. The amount of entertainment that we cover here and the amount of entertainment that everyone enjoys is due to in part to these workers. And if they are struggling to live by the work they are doing, that is a problem.
Mm-hmm.
And even when it all started, you know, they did this back in 2008
for the writers. The actors have not been on strike since 1980.
Right. But we've seen just like someone like Bryan Cranston on the line. They've been to New York. They've been to, I saw they were most recently in New York.
Well, they're in both New York and LA primarily, because there are two different guilds.
Yeah, but support them. And if you're there, don't treat them like Zoom monkeys and like, oh my God, the actors are here. Understand the cause.
Yeah, and I've seen a lot of people say like, well, they're all billionaires. They're all millionaires who have mansions. SAG has 160,000 members. Name me 160,000 A-list actors right now.
You can't.
Exactly, because like you think about the actors who come in for 4 days and shoot two or three small scenes, and that's about it.
We're talking about writers that wrote whole shows, and their residuals are minute.
Yeah, I mean, honestly, like I think the most difficult issue with the strike is the residuals, because how streaming works, it's not like streamers don't make money from what you watch. They make money from your subscriptions.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So that's like the only thing where it's like how I think it's gonna end is it's gonna be like they have to pay a lot more upfront. They have to pay a lot more upfront. Just consistent jobs. The big thing is like the AI use. Now, that's not a big thing. But
I think it's a part, but AI use we've already seen. We can get AI to tell us how to not cook chocolate chip cookies. Being safe with that one, but getting AI to write a attainable show is something that only really a human has
done. Well, I mean, AI even right now, I mean, you can type in, like, write me season 4 of The Mandalorian, and it's not good. It's not well written whatsoever. And I don't believe any studio would ever use that. But it's like maybe like you know, well, we had AI come up with the first idea, so they get some of the credit, even though you wrote the scripts. We're gonna dock your pay a little bit because of that.
Yeah,
Angus, what are your thoughts?
I don't know. I mean, I've been thinking about these strikes and, you know, such lately because I actually recently read a memoir, a book by Simu Liu, who played Shang-Chi in Marvel. And Ken. And one of the Kens, of course. And, you know, he talks about, especially, you know, the halfway point towards the end of when he started to try to get big in Hollywood, how much difficulty he faced, not only as an Asian American, and an Asian Canadian, but
Canada.
But also, you know, he talks about how even not only for minority actors, but just for non-A-list, non-B-list actors in general, it's super, super difficult to get yourself started in the industry. And like Drew said, you know, there are 160,000 members of SAG. So thousands upon thousands of these people are just average, everyday Joes who are trying to get better pay, better wages, better treatment, and they deserve that. Because, yeah, like we've all said, you know, they help to make the things we love, and they deserve rightful compensation.
If you are talented enough to make it in this industry, you deserve to be able to pay your bills and to pay for food and to raise your family.
Yeah. I mean, I think that about sums it up.
Yeah. And Drew, you said earlier, name 160,000 A-list actors. You can't. The movies we see, that A-list actors are a minute percentage. And to make another basketball reference this episode, it's like the amount of NBA players we see, like all these NBA kids that want to play in the league, and all the basketball players that we see, all the youth leagues, minute percentage that actually get into it, make the big money, make the checks that allow for these mansions of, oh, we're at Robert Downey Jr.'s house, and he has the Avengers symbol outside. Like, yeah, that's every actor. No, it's like five.
It's maybe at most like 0.9, maybe 1%.
I love when you make up statistics.
I know.
It's so hot. But for your point, it's a very small number.
Cut it out post.
I'm the poster.
Yeah, no, but overall, I think that about sums it up. You know, support actors, support writers, because otherwise we don't have these amazing shows, these amazing movies. So, yeah.
And we'll catch you on the next clip.
Which is Lando.
Hopefully we stick the landing into the next segment.
Oh my God, bro.
I'm backwards, you idiot!
To kind of go back to the earlier point of Kathleen Kennedy, so about 3 years ago, they announced this all-new Lando series for Disney Plus.
With the Donald Glover, a.k.a. Childish Gambino.
Well, they didn't announce
that. Troy from Community,
yeah,
my favorite show ever.
And
really?
It was announced that Justin Simien was going to be the showrunner behind that series. We've not heard much about that since, and Justin Simien just directed Disney's Haunted Mansion, which I cannot say if that's good or bad. I've not seen it yet.
It had a bunch of really good actors.
Yeah.
And then I heard it did bad.
Yeah. It totally flopped at the box office.
Bad with a capital B.
But just
B.
Because a movie does badly at the box office does not mean it's a bad movie.
Like Bullet Strays Train. And Joyride and Indiana Jones and, in my opinion, Flash. Simien was talking about Lando, and he's like, yeah, I had not heard, like, I was working on it in, like, summer of 2020, and then I just stopped hearing from Lucasfilm. About 6 months later, they announced that I was still writing the show at, like, publicly at that event, and then he has allegedly not heard from Lucasfilm since.
What happened during 2020?
Are you referring to the pandemic?
Yeah, I mean COVID.
I mean, email still works.
Yeah, dude, Disney is like, I'm sorry, probably one of the biggest corporations in the world in terms of influence, at least. And
I'm saying...
And you're trying to make the excuse that because of COVID, in which...
Kathleen Kennedy still has the responsibility to follow up with her creators.
All right, to backtrack to what we were starting, because I started this segment wrong. You said at the start, and it was during the summer 2020, he was still writing.
Yeah. And or then, not writing, but like developing, working on.
Developing,
so
working on.
So Disney just ghosted him.
A little bit.
Disney just ghosted him.
Allegedly. Nice. Yeah. So he's out, and it's, Donald and Stephen Glover are writing these series now. So
we can. Glover?
It's his brother Glover. The Glover brothers.
I didn't know that was
the thing. Two pairs make a glove.
So it really seems to me like this show is gonna be and they did at Atlanta, which is awesome. Mm-hmm. Swarm, which I've not seen but I've heard is really good.
And Donald Glover made a lot of good things.
A lot of great things.
He influenced across the Spider-Verse and the Spider-Verse series.
But yeah, what I hope we get from this show is like Billy Dee narrating it like bookends, and then Donald Glover acting in the middle. So for our next segment, we are going to be talking about Ahsoka.
Yes,
first episode. Cannot wait for it. So the latest Star Wars series on Disney Plus. We are now 3 episodes into Ahsoka. Mm-hmm. What I really love about this show is they're doing it like we get like prime time 8 p.m. episode drops.
Took it from Ted Lasso, which is great.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
please more shows do this.
I mean, it's been fun because Angus, you've been coming over and we've been watching the episodes. We've been talking about it. We've had pizza. Michael, you've not been able to make it yet.
I've been doing other things.
Because Michael hates
things.
Us.
Michael hates us. Michael hates Star Wars.
I'm the head of sports for this place. I need to do things.
Yeah, we understand.
Busy.
We understand that work is better than life. You know, more important to you, I guess. Can't spend time with your real family.
Your Star Wars family. And, but anyway.
God, it's like being...
But yeah, it's been super fun just getting to watch these episodes at 8 p.m. Just it feels like, you know, like Game of Thrones having friends over and watching it together.
Friends? That's crazy.
But I've been really, really enjoying the show. It's not like... So basically where I'm at with this...
Better than Andor.
Full spoilers, because... It's been out for a while.
Yeah, full spoilers.
Sorry to our crew.
Back out of here. Take a hyperspace lane. Get out of here. Spoilers. That's also a joke.
To me, this is like, you know, it's great. And I said this during episode 3. It's great Star Wars, but it's not great TV. It's kind of like the
elaborate.
The prequels.
Expand.
No, fewer metaphors, more elaborate.
Yeah, like.
All right. Just to me, this show, I mean... It's not very like it's written like Clone Wars and Rebels, which are great for Clone Wars and Rebels.
Yeah.
Though,
well, Dave Filoni.
Those
yeah,
are
Dave
series.
Filoni did.
But in a live action show, I kind of just expect like a higher quality of the writing.
Why does live action have that many higher
quality?
Well,
no, hold on. What part of the writing do you feel isn't as high quality?
Right.
There were
like compared to something like The Mandalorian.
I don't remember any lines off the top of my head, but like there were like several times in episode 3 where just like characters just like kind of say things. And again, I'm like. For the most part, very much enjoying this show. It's just like, I think that the dialogue is pretty weak.
I think, honestly, if you go back and you watch The Clone Wars, right, which is by far one of the pieces of Star Wars media that, like, most fans can actually agree is good, right?
Yeah.
You can almost never get that to happen with Star Wars fans because they're all little toxic babies.
We got a little bit of that with the first 2 scenes of Mando.
Yeah, sure. But, Clone Wars, right, is like a treasured piece of media for everyone. And yet, if you go back and watch, especially, like, first 3 seasons, dude, there are some weird lines. There are some just, like, NPC, like, okay, master, I think we've got this.
Snips, don't go to the gunfire.
Those rates are going down, right? Like, to have Ahsoka say one weird thing in episode 3 is not the end of the world.
You know, I don't even know what you're talking about.
I acknowledge it's super nitpicky. I wish that I wrote stuff down, but I didn't. But anyway... But that is truly the only negative that I have other than, like, these stupid run times of being 35 minutes. That's ridiculous.
Yeah, I wish it was a bit longer.
I mean, I think it was a great, like, that was an episode, like, if it was any longer, I'm like, what else are we still doing here? Where else? I don't think they could have continued that episode without another 40 minutes to be like, oh, we're finally here.
A good writer can create more story.
And I
was saying that Filoni's a bad writer. I'm just saying, like, a great writer would be able to create sort of to fill another 15 minutes.
Hmm. But first, before we talk about episode 3, I think we should really just quickly cover the first 2 that were released.
We're kind of jumping the gun here.
Yeah, 2 weeks ago. So, in my opinion, I actually had gone into Ahsoka with very, very low expectations, if not negative expectations.
Dude, I remember, like, you said, like, all right, guys, get ready to see Correct. Another lovely childhood character destroyed by Disney.
Yeah, because I don't know, I really try to stay positive about the new Disney shows. I despise when people, like, just randomly hate on Disney, because I think a lot of their Star Wars stuff has been great. But I did not have...
Season 7.
Yeah. I did not have great expectations for this show. And after the first two episodes, when I watched them with Drew, you know, he can confirm, I was hyped. I really liked them. I thought, you know, for a just Disney Plus show, the CGI was great.
Yeah.
I thought, I'd love to see David Tennant back as Huyang. I loved...
Which is not what I was expecting until I saw the Lego. Like,
I totally forgot that David Tennant was going to be in the show. Because I remember that they talked about that at Star Wars Celebration. I totally forgot about that.
Same here.
Yeah. No, it was surprising, but yeah. I also really thought that the casting was good.
Yeah.
I don't think it's amazing, but I think it was good. I don't really see the merit in the people online who are saying, like...
Recast, you know, Hera. That's
recast Hera, recast Sabine. Like,
that's so dumb.
It's very dumb. Yeah. And I think...
They're doing amazing.
Also, again, guys, the show is called Ahsoka. Like, the other characters from Rebels, it's great to see them again, but they are supporting characters, right? The main characters are Ahsoka and Baylan, and I forget the apprentice's name.
Shinhati.
Shin.
Yeah.
One of the things that I think Dave Filoni did a wonderful job with was, if you didn't watch Clone Wars or Rebels, he does a great job just, like, catching up. Yes, there are things...
Yeah.
That,
for sure.
That you miss. Like, same thing, like...
writer does.
Yeah.
They create their own individual project without having to rely too much on the callbacks, which is why I love the way they did the timeline.
Oh, yeah.
They start the first two episodes before the Rebels finale, and so you already know that Sabine is grieving the loss of a friend and brother, as Ezra puts it in the hologram, and then Ahsoka is having conflicting stories, but it's also on her own journey that we see, and that has been started.
Yeah, yeah, I was a little bit nervous that this show is just going to pick up, like, right after the Rebels finale. And it's just, like, that wouldn't have been
a good
satisfying for a viewer of watching Ahsoka as its own standalone story. Like, even if I have the context of Clone Wars and Rebels, like, Ahsoka as a standalone story, I think, would suffer a bit from not having a true beginning.
To be fair, how many people are watching Ahsoka that haven't seen Clone Wars? Haven't seen Mandalorian, haven't seen Rebels.
Well, I think there are a good number of people.
I was going to go into that. First of all, going back to what Badrov just said, I think that it's really interesting that Dave Filoni has been able to make his universe, his characters, his sort of storylines accessible to people.
Right.
Because I've actually, you know, I'm not just a Star Wars nerd, I'm like just a nerd in general. I've been reading Fellowship of the Ring, and as much as I love Lord of the Rings, and I've probably watched the movies like 8,000 times, Tolkien has kind of a nerd problem of not really making his universe, his world clear. Like, you have a dictionary. You gotta be like, oh, who is like Ecthelion? Oh, yes, he's this guy. So
Smog.
It can be difficult. But I think Dave Filoni makes it very clear, especially explaining who Thrawn is, right? Because for a lot of the normies, they're like, oh, who's this blue guy? Who's Thrawn?
And we haven't seen him yet.
Grand Admiral Thrawn. And then they explain it well. And actually, I was, again, talking to my boss at work, and, you know, he hasn't watched Rebels, has not watched Clone Wars, has no idea who Ahsoka or any of the characters are.
Shout out,
Sigan
Bai.
He was like, I kind of like this show so far. It's really cool. You know, it's got space battles, which is all I really ask for. And, you know, I'm excited to see this Thrawn guy, because he sounds kind of scary.
I mean,
kind of
scary.
Look, as much as I love Clone Wars Rebels, and again, Clone Wars is what made me a Star Wars fan.
Better than Andor.
A lot of people write them off as kids shows and didn't watch them. They are not right for that. They are not wrong for that. But we as Star Wars fans in our circles greatly overestimate how many people watch everything.
Our bias at Clone Wars is that we grew up with Clone Wars.
Yeah.
The first three episodes, the first three seasons is Angus Allan. The dialogue's a little bit choppy. Ahsoka's still a kid. The last four episodes are war crimes, disbelief, and then, you know, the betrayal of the clones is one of the saddest endings of all time.
I don't think Clone Wars would even appeal to someone who's not a lifelong Star Wars fan.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think anybody can watch Clone Wars. Just because it's so rooted in Star Wars lore that if you've just seen the movies and you like the movies and you're just trying to watch Clone Wars, I feel like it's a little bit too much.
But back to Ahsoka, I think that's the difference between Ahsoka and Clone Wars. Clone Wars assumes you know about the Star Wars universe, that's why you're watching it. But Ahsoka assumes that you don't know about Ahsoka.
Yeah.
So it's allowing watchers to use a little bit of their own analytical thinking and connect their own dots and see how they go along the way, which I absolutely love as a watcher. She's already on this planet for a puzzle, and I have that puzzle scene where she's solving it out and has the ruins. It kind of reminds me of Zeffo in Fallen Order. The puzzle's my only nitpick so far, because it's a little Rubik's Cube that I could have fiddled with and got the light to shine.
Yeah.
But other than that, I think that as a connecting plot, that puzzle is a great starting place.
I've got another little nitpick. Ahsoka should have had somebody with her during her first scene, because it's just 4 minutes of no talking.
I disagree.
I also disagree as well.
It's Ahsoka.
I think in a world where every piece of media has to be this packed, deep, insane, intense thing, I think we forget about the origins of film. Go back to a Hitchcock film. There are scenes where it's 8 minutes of no talking and no dialogue.
That allows us to sit and actually. I'm sorry, I'm cutting you off, but I think this point needs to be. That scene allows us to actually get just a feel what Ahsoka can bring to the show. And we know she's intelligent. We know that she's skilled. We see the lightsabers ignite, just bang.
She's a very calm person as well, though.
Right.
And, we see that she's not, frantically searching for this. She's being very calm and collected and careful
I've got to go back to reference my favorite film of all time. It's a lot like the opening of Raiders of the Lost Ark, where it's just Indy kind of
Right. Is anyone else there with Indy?
Yeah, there was.
Actually, that's true. Never mind.
Alfred Molina.
Okay. That's why Indy always has somebody there with him to talk to.
Yeah, Ahsoka doesn't need that, because Ahsoka's been alone for the past...
Yeah. That is
Anyways,
fair. No.
This is kind of arbitrary. We need to cover the third episode.
Yes.
Yeah.
First two,
thank you,
awesome.
Yeah. Yes.
Well, let's talk about Baylan for a second.
Baylan,
that
intro of the villains.
I think these guys are probably some of my favorites. Let me think about this a little bit, later. But
Can I get started off then?
Oh, yeah, sure.
The villain introduction of Baylan and Shin is masterful, because we see that the Rebel Alliance is still scattered. The New Republic is still scattered across the world. And so when they see two Jedi come aboard, their immediate instinct is to trust Jedi. And so Baylan and Shin get on there, and they're acting... It's kind of like No Country for Old Men. So they get on there, and no one thinks that they're going to die. This officer's
kind of... Well, but also they don't always trust them, though.
Right.
Either. They actually expect them to just be liars, and so they're very overconfident about that. They're this is a great disguise,
That officer's kind of asking for it, it's a great disguise. And he
pulls out the lightsaber. I kind of wanted him to get stabbed.
Just a little bit. But then, that's a horror. That whole ship is gone.
Mm-hmm.
None of that crew is left, and they went through all of them.
Yeah.
And that's a Darth Vader scene that we just didn't see.
I was also confused, though. Maybe I missed something, but how come they just randomly attacked? I mean, it was a cool introduction.
Wait,
but they don't really give an explanation for why Baylan and Shin randomly attacked.
So, because that ship was transporting Morgan Elsbeth.
It was a prison ship. That's right. sorry.
All right. I think... let me, rephrase this once, we've seen the whole season. But I think Baylan has a shot at becoming my favorite villain of the Disney era.
Rest in peace to Ray.
Oh my God, Ray Stevenson. Phenomenal job so far. I think that he has a chance at passing Kylo Ren as my favorite villain of the Disney era.
Yeah, my only problem is that we didn't see more of him in episode two. He was just kind of standing there this, but really ominous and really cool. I'm totally going to go home to your mother tonight.
I think that it's going to... I mean, we'll talk predictions later, but I do think he's going to have, a very major role as we move forward in the show.
I don't think after this season... Do we know if there's going to be another season?
So, at the Disney investor presentation where they announced Lando and this show and a lot of other things, Kathleen Kennedy did refer to this as a miniseries.
Okay, then that means I'm glad as...
But Andor is a two-season miniseries.
Okay, so maybe. The prediction is maybe. As Rey has passed, very sadly. And that was... He did not get to see Ahsoka come out.
Rey Skywalker, by the way. Rey Stevens.
No. Rey Stevenson.
Rey to clarify.
To clarify, yes. But I'm very sad that his portrayal of Baylan has... He will never get to see that. And apologies to his family and those who have lost him and the actor and crew.
Condolences to the family.
Condolences.
Yeah. No, he has done a phenomenal job. I loved seeing Corellia.
Corellia was
come
great.
Back.
That was cool. Lothal was great.
Yeah.
Lothal was beautiful.
Oh, my God, Lothal. Like, I mean, Rebels,
Remind
I grew
me
up
of home.
Rebels, too.
Just like Illinois, just endless corn.
Endless corn and highways.
Yeah, Rebels, I mean, just getting to, like I had the biggest smile on my face, just, like, seeing Sabine in live action for the first
and
time.
Clancy Brown,
who and Clancy Brown. And Clancy Brown, which I didn't pick up on my first viewing, was seeing him back as Ryder.
He was actually not the voice actor for Ryder for Rebels.
I thought he was.
I checked on IMDb. So,
I also checked on IMDb.
I think it was something that sounds a lot similar to him, but Clancy looks like Ryder.
Yeah. I thought it was a good casting.
And then
first two episodes were good. What I liked overall about the third episode,
yes,
I thought the Purrgil...
Yeah, he did.
He did?
Yeah.
He did?
Yes.
Okay.
On IMDb. Clancy Brown as Ryder Azadi.
I stand corrected.
Yeah. I thought the Purrgil, that introduction was really cool.
Yes.
I thought the CGI was awesome for a Disney Plus show. Like,
oh, my God.
The ship scene with Ahsoka just kind of balling out there on top of the T-17.
I was skeptical of that at first. I was like, this is kind of weird. But it reminded me of the Clone Wars.
Right.
It felt like something they would do in Clone
Anakin
Wars.
Anakin Skywalker would have totally pulled out. Like, mm-hmm. Yeah, come at me, bro.
And
yeah. You
know what? This show, as much as I loved Andor, I have not been this excited about the future of Star Wars in a long time as I am with this show.
Oh, yeah.
Like,
oh, yeah.
It's been it's been since Mando season 2. So that was about 3 years ago.
And I find that I'm actually excited for the next week's episode.
Yeah.
With Book of Boba Fett, I was like, oh, God, is it going to be something really bad again? Is it going to be, is there going to be a weird goof? Like,
Kenobi,
I was like, oh, let's just get this over with. I kind of want to see what happens, but not really.
I think there's
with this, I'm like, oh, shoot, what's going to happen in the forest? Because at the end of the episode, Baylan is like, they must be hiding in the forest.
I stand by this
Find
opinion.
Them. And it's really epic.
This is very quick because I actually really want to talk about Ahsoka, but some of the Star Wars shows, they need to actually release them all at once instead of bit by bit. Ahsoka is one of these shows where I think it works bit by bit, but Kenobi should have been all at once. Book of Boba should have been all at once. Andor, I'm like half and half on, but I think like maybe 3 episodes a week for Andor, for like the arcs. But I think that works better because a big complaint is it took this long for them to get to this conclusion.
This is a debate for another time because I completely disagree with you on that.
Angus, what do you say?
But
Angus.
Yeah.
Angus.
Yeah. I really loved all the episodes. That space battle felt so Star Wars to me.
It was very Star Wars.
Yes.
I loved it.
And that shuttle is great. I love how...
Also, sorry, go ahead.
No, you go.
I was just going to say, David Tennant, hilarious.
This human.
Like,
oh my God.
Like, it felt like a C-3. I mean, it wasn't a C-3PO copycat. That's what I liked.
He's like the Alfred to Ahsoka.
Exactly. It was very funny. I loved how he's constantly getting turned off and he's like, oh, what happened?
He reminded me a little bit of Tars from Interstellar. Have you guys seen that?
Yeah,
I don't know. Just kind of like, not completely, but just a little bit of,
the
dry humor.
Now, if he starts reminding us of Hal from 2001, we shall be scared.
Yeah.
Watch out. Open
but
the door, Ahsoka.
Overall.
Open the door.
Hal. Episode 3, I really felt that it was, like, solid. I liked the Purrgil scene. I think I'm excited for this forest battle or whatever it's leading up to.
Yep, Marak. That's going to be the Battle of Marak, as we saw from the trailers.
Okay.
Who's also really cool.
Yeah.
I think it's not Ezra. Anyone that says Ezra, no. Anyone says it's Malik, Galen Merrick, no.
No. Ezra is off in this.
It's Cal Kestis, people.
All right. I think I'm the only person on the planet who didn't completely hate Star Wars Resistance.
Didn't even watch.
It's not a great show. It's the worst Star Wars show, but I didn't hate it. Seeing seeing the Ziono character, the senator, just seeing him come back, just like for a little cameo, just made the universe feel a bit more connected to me.
I understand what you're saying, but who's it? I don't know who that is.
He was the one that was like dissing Hera. Yeah. Like, you don't get no fleet.
And you know what I really liked about the show is and all these shows.
Oh, was he Asian?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
They're setting up the sort of hubris of the new Republic and showing why they fell. Because I think that's one of the biggest story sins of the sequel film.
Which has been a very big part, besides Book of Boba Fett, which is about Boba Fett, but Andor, we immediately saw it in the early stages. We saw it immediately with Mandalorian Season 3.
Mm-hmm.
Not Andor,
because that's like 12 years before this.
No, Andor, because of how connected the Empire was at the early stages of the Empire, but how disconnected New Republic is. That's my connection. I didn't really explain that.
Yeah, that makes sense.
But we saw it in Episode 2, where like Hera and Ahsoka go, oh, we're going to go find where this hyperspring ring is. And then he played a doctor in House MD.
I've never heard of that show. If I'm being
it's clear. A great show. But this dude, the foreman, is like, we don't have any Imperial loyalists, and then gets shot at, and then is an Imperial loyalist. Mm-hmm. That's a huge problem. Because no one did background checks.
All right. So, guys, what is your favorite singular thing about Ahsoka so far?
Any specific episode? Or
just of the first three episodes, what is your favorite element of the show?
This is a sort of specific and hard to describe, but I'll try to do it quickly. I feel like what I've always loved in the shows that take place after Order 66 is the feel that the Jedi Order, even though a lot of Jedi have died, is still alive, right? There are still things of it that remain. There's still hope for the Jedi to return. And to me, that is embodied in Hoyan. Because he's literally programmed as like a representative of the Jedi Order. He has all these lightsabers in his collection, in his database, and it's just really cool. It kind of brings me back to the Republic.
One of the things I love about Baylan is like he's like, no, we can't kill Ahsoka. She's like one.
He didn't
one
say we
could. Jedi.
He just said it'd be a shame.
It'd be a shame. Yeah. That one line makes the characters like that much like deeper and more complex. And I
because
love that.
Because he has honor.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He understands and he respects her.
For me, it's Chopper. Seeing Chopper back. Oh my god. Like,
no,
because
every time he would be like, oh my god, it's Chopper. Oh my god, it's Chopper.
Those of us who grew up watching Rebels, like, we can understand what Chopper's saying. Like we can get the gist of what he's saying from the bub. Like, we know what that is.
Drop the thing. Why can't we drop the thing? It'll kill them all, Chopper.
He's still committing all the fine. War crimes. Choppenheimer.
What mutter? That's the whole premise of Chopper. And my favorite thing? Do I get my favorite thing? The lightsaber fights. I think they have rejuvenated what lightsabers mean in Star Wars.
I think they're getting there. For me, like, they're
anyone
not.
Anyone that says, like, oh, like, she got Sabine got stabbed and immediately died, she got medical attention, like, immediately after, dude.
Yeah.
Reva, she had, like, a powerful force thing. Qui-Gon Jinn, probably never been stabbed with a lightsaber before. Mm-hmm. Didn't know how to treat that. But the lightsaber fights, Ahsoka and the droids at the start, amazing. I think that was really cool. And then Shin and Sabine had an amazing fight. For Sabine being kind of reminded me of like new Luke Skywalker versus Darth Vader in Empire Strikes Back. And then Ahsoka is going to have, I think, some of the best lightsabers continue on the Baylan, Marak, Shin. She's going to face all three of them.
Yeah. And like one of the things that I really love about Sabine, which I was really scared about, was like they're just going to like make her a Jedi. And like, no, she has like almost no connection to the Force whatsoever.
Which we'll talk about in the predictions. I was very surprised that Sabine was even going to be on this path.
Well, we kind of knew about that.
No, we didn't.
I kind of expected
like because they kind of talk about that.
Because Ahsoka needs an apprentice. She doesn't have Ezra.
Right.
All right. Should we get to predictions?
Let's talk about predictions. So we will talk about predictions right after this.
What if this were all happening right now? What if Luke Skywalker were fighting against the Death Star and trying to rescue a princess?
Terminate her immediately.
What if you could go with them?
Come on!
Well, you can. Tomorrow at a theater near you. Star Wars, rated PG.
So we now have time to talk about where we think Ahsoka's going to go in the next 5 episodes. So, Mike, you had some predictions, probably more than the rest of us, so you can...
Ahsoka is definitely going to have to make the choice of training Sabine and then trying to progress her own mission. I think there's going to be the Sabine-Ahsoka dynamic. I didn't see that coming during Rebels at all. When, like, Sabine leaves at the end of the Rebels finale to go with Ahsoka, I didn't say, like, oh, Sabine's going to be a Jedi. That's cool. I didn't see that at all. I saw Sabine and Ahsoka had, like, a path to Ezra. That was what I thought the Rebels finale was alluding to. And then the first 2 episodes illuminated, oh, Sabine actually trained with Ahsoka after the Battle of Lothal and stuff, and went to go train around. I think that's a cool dynamic. I don't have any problem with it whatsoever. I actually welcome it, seeing a non-Force user have to train with lightsabers.
That's really cool.
Really cool and really unique and creative. And also a Mandalorian Jedi.
Yeah.
Also,
well, they kind of indirectly reference Tari Vizsla in part 3.
Mm-hmm.
Grogu.
And Grogu? When did they talk about Grogu? I think I missed that part.
Grogu's kind of like...
talk about him, but he's a Mandalorian Jedi.
Yeah, he's a family.
Yeah, he is. He's a Mandalorian.
But my prediction is that Sabine and Ahsoka... I don't think Sabine's dying, but I do think that Sabine is going to be not what Ahsoka... is not going to get the path. I don't think there's a happy ending for Sabine becoming a Jedi there.
I think that the Ezra Bridger that they are looking for...
Is gone.
I think Ezra will have changed a lot. I always...
Is Ezra even alive, is my point.
I think Ezra's alive. No, because...
They
cast someone to play Ezra, and they have an action figure for Ezra. I don't think they would do that if it's just going to be one hologram.
I think they would. I think the expectations for Virgin there is too good to pass up. Thrawn surviving, but Ezra's not.
I mean, look, if Ezra is dead... I'm not going to, like, I'll be a little sad about it, but it's like, all right, well, that's the story they want to tell. That's fine. But I don't know. I think it would be a little bit more interesting. And just to, like, have maybe Ezra sort of maybe, like, compared to maybe, like, Winter Soldier type thing, where he's very
changed.
That's what I would love to see.
I was mentioning this. I think it might be a Bucky Barnes kind of thing.
Yeah.
I also think as... because I don't have too many specific predictions.
Right.
But one of the sort of general ideas I had was that I think there might be some intra-rivalry between...
I love prefixes.
I love prefixes. Yes.
Intra-rivalry between Shin and Baylan, or perhaps Baylan and Shin versus Morgan.
I think, yeah, Baylan and Shin more than with Morgan than I think Baylan and Shin against each other.
But then again, you know, people are like, oh, maybe Baylan will be like, hey, helping Morgan is not, you know, the way, and he still has sympathies to the Jedi, and he decides to help Ahsoka. Then it's like Morgan against like 3 or 4 decently trained, you know, Force users, or, you know, plus Sabine or whatever. So then, to me, that's a very unfair fight. I don't see Disney doing that, because then it's like, why wouldn't they just destroy Morgan, you know?
I do think it's actually like Baylan's going for power here. He's not. He said it, unlimited power. He's definitely going, taking that influence from like, okay, Anakin. He knew that Anakin and what he became, that was because of the secret power, and he got that as Darth Vader for a while there.
Mm-hmm.
But who is Morak? So, who's your prediction for Morak?
I think Morak is just
a new character.
Yeah,
a new character.
Like people are just like speculating. Oh my God, it's Sam Witwer. Yeah, Sam Witwer might be doing the voice. I don't believe there is any chance in Mustafar that it is Starkiller.
I don't think so.
I see a lot of people like Spider-Man.
If anyone says Starkiller, needs to understand how overpowered he was.
Rampant fan speculation, which we are all guilty of. We've all done that. But like, I don't think there's any
Starkiller
real
chance.
Also, calling this up, because in 2016, I was... like 10, right?
Right.
So I don't remember this, but looking back, you know, watching videos now, there was a big trend when the trailer for The Force Awakens came out, predicting that... Wait, no, I was not 10.
You were 11.
The Force Awakens came out in 2015, so the trailer...
Okay, anyways, it doesn't matter. There's a big trend predicting that, you know, the man underneath the mask of Kylo Ren was actually a Luke Skywalker who had gone to the dark side.
I do remember that, yeah.
And... it obviously turned out way different from
then that. Then we saw the sweet, sweet face of
Adam Driver. The new Ferrari trailer. Mike, he looks great in that. Anyway.
Yes. Anyways, Drew. I think, honestly, Maraca is just some random Sith servant.
Inquisitor.
With really cool armor.
Yeah. Guys,
do we think that we're going to see Maraca fly like a helicopter
in
the show?
Yes.
Because Dave Filoni.
It's really cool.
Here's how I think that will be used. I think it'll be like he has to jump from a super high place that not even a Jedi could survive that fall, and maybe he used that to, like, as a type of parachute.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think you can, like, I don't think that in live action you can have that and have it not look completely stupid. Flying away with his lightsaber.
I don't think he's going to go up. I think if he's doing it, he's going to be going down slowly.
Like a Mario propeller hat when you're about to die in like Super Mario Bros. Yeah. Like,
oh, okay. Prediction. So how many episodes are there confirmed?
Eight.
Okay. We have five left.
What episode do you think we're going to see Ezra in? And what episode do you think we'll see Thrawn in? And do you think they'll be in the same episode?
Thrawn in 5, Ezra in 7.
I was going to say Thrawn 6 and Ezra 7, or maybe that'll be flipped. Like, I think we're going to get one of them, like, the episode before the other, and it's going to be either episode 6 or episode 7.
I think episode 4 leaves off of them actually, like, activating the hyperspace ring with all of them on it, kind of like a Tom Holland Infinity War, Spider-Man's on the ring. And then, like, episode 5, we actually get to the planet, and that's when we see, like, Thrawn.
Yeah, because, and when do you think we are going to see Hayden? If we're going to see Hayden. I don't think we are.
I think going back to Kenobi, I have a feeling that Ahsoka's going to have, because so far she's been very confident, right? It's a big flip from, like, looking at her in the early Clone Wars or even in later Clone Wars, where she still has these doubts about herself, about her power, about her ability to succeed. She seems very confident now. Even in these stressful situations, she's like, she's very calm and collected.
She went out into the middle of space.
Exactly.
And fought like a giant Japanese fighter.
She's become a Jedi Master. And I know people are like, oh, she's not a Jedi, but whatever.
Dude.
A Jedi Master now. But
I think from a story perspective, I don't think she needs to see Hayden, but I think given that it's Dave Filoni writing the show, he's not going to pass up the opportunity to have Rosario Dawson,
if we do
Ahsoka,
see Hayden,
and Hayden Christensen's Anakin together.
If we do see Hayden, it's going to be episode 8. Like, it's a big final battle.
I think it'll be the beginning of episode 8.
What I was going with the Kenobi, before I sidetracked myself, was that...
We love when you sidetrack.
I think Hayden is going to show up when Ahsoka has gone through an extremely humiliating or difficult time, right? Maybe Sabine's maybe not killed, but, like, captured or something, and Ahsoka feels like she's failed everyone. Maybe after the hyperspace ring activates and they still make it through, and Thrawn returns and he's blowing crap up, you know, maybe Ahsoka's like, oh my god, I failed. And then that's when Hayden appears and it's like, no, you know.
I really hope Ahsoka doesn't get captured. Like they pull Mandalore in season 3. I really hope it's not like Sabine has to go, like, help Ahsoka with these new trained Jedi powers.
I'm kind of tired of, like, rescue missions.
Yeah.
Oh my god, there have been so many of those. So many rescue missions in recent Star Wars.
I mean, I know they're going for, like, a Ezra rescue,
right,
but that's different.
That's
because
different.
He's been gone for, like, years.
And it's also the entire plot of the show and not just, like, here, we have to fill up an episode. Let's do that.
Yeah. Half the plot, half the other plot is finding Thrawn.
Well,
Thrawn.
It's plot A, plot B. They're kind of together.
Coming at you from the deep blue rim, we got Thrawn coming back to you to reinstate the Empire.
I can't wait
to see Thrawn. Last prediction that I have to bring up. I think that this season will not actually end with Thrawn, like, amassing his massive fleet and just a bunch of wins. I think what's going to happen is they go to the place, I don't think it's in the Outer Regions, right? It's another galaxy.
It's like, we'll call
it's
it
a different galaxy.
Galaxy 2.
They go to this other galaxy, Galaxy 2, and that's where most of the rest of the show is, right? At least for Ahsoka, Sabine, Hoyang. And then, just hear me out, the final episode, the Imperials try to move the fleet through, and the hyperspace ring is deactivated halfway through, and so the fleet is crushed. Just demolished. And Thrawn, right? Thrawn is not going to give up then. I think he will survive if Dave Filoni is going to make the heir to the Empire.
Thrawn doesn't give up.
But he's going to be like, at first, I thought Ahsoka was, you know, a possible rival. Now she is my enemy, and I will destroy her.
I've underestimated her.
He's going to regroup. That's an epic setup.
Shadow Council.
Yeah.
The Shadow Council council toward the end of Mando season 3.
Right. Yeah. Thrawn is a strategist, right?
Right.
I think he will regroup. He's going to re-strategize, and that's setting up the new conflict
with Lars Mikkelsen.
I Yeah, I really cannot wait to see him come back. I hope this is what we all wanted Quantumania to be, of sort of like setting up the next big bad mm-hmm. for Marvel, except this is for Star Wars. I hope this is like Quantumania, but great.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Do you think we are going to see the world between worlds? Just yeah,
yes.
Quick yeah. yes or no? Yeah, yes. I think we're going to. All
right.
Well, guys, that's going to
about do it for Ahsoka.
About
do
it for Ahsoka.
We'll until next week.
Right back, right after this. Thank you so much for tuning into the season 2 premiere of Tusken Radio. It has been an absolute treat and a pleasure to come back into this wonderful room of Star Wars love that we all have. Yes. I am Drew Grech.
I'm Mike Badrov.
And I'm Angus Allan.
And we will be back next week for more news, more Ahsoka, and more fun times. I have spoken.